to you. You are going to receive healing to your church and healing to your life, healing to your marriage, healing to everything that concerns you. And without much ado this morning, I have this single honor on the behalf of Papa to introduce this great man of God. Can we put our hands together as we receive to the podium the ministry of Bishop Louis Nterful. Hallelujah. Do that better.
Hallelujah. Put your hands together for the Lord. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. How many of you are happy to be here this wonderful afternoon? Amen. I want to thank once again God's great servant, Dr. Ampiah-Kwofi, for the invitation to preach this afternoon. It's a blessing always to be here. I believe that the Lord is doing wonderful things in your midst, and it's a blessing to be here. I want to acknowledge and appreciate all the pastors that are supporting him. Continue with the good work, and the Lord will continue to bless this great denomination. Amen. Let us pray. Father, thank you for the opportunity to be in your presence. In the name of Jesus, thank you, Lord, Holy Spirit, for your presence, for your guidance. We ask for the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of you and of your ways. Holy Spirit, speak to our hearts and impact to our spirits this afternoon in the name of Jesus. Amen. Give the Lord a wonderful clap offering. Hallelujah. Amen. Well, this afternoon, I want to be doing some teachings. All right, so basically, I want to believe God to teach on some very important principles about the subject of loyalty. Now, as a family, we are believing God to expand, to grow, and to affect our nation, Ghana, and other nations. Amen. Now, it is very, very important for us as a people, as a church, to have a vision to see the gospel of Jesus Christ reaching many, many, many places. Hallelujah. How many of you know that millions in the world are not saved? Millions, how many of you know that? The millions in the world are not saved. Millions in our country are not saved. When I was driving here, I saw so many outdoor publicity of church programs, especially crossover service. And I was telling the pastors that I was driving with that it is a blessing to see so many churches and so many pastors. And I also added that it will be even a greater blessing if all of us, as churches, as pastors, as the people of God, had in mind to win the lost. And not just have church, but to win the lost. That our churches would be so winning minded and would be eternity minded. And that we'll dedicate ourselves to to reaching out to lost humanity wherever we can find them in our community. But you see, unfortunately, most of the church is not spiritual. The church is very materialistic. Amen. There's nothing wrong with having money, having a good education, driving a good car, living in a house. There's nothing wrong with that. But it should not become the aim of a Christian. The aim of a Christian should not be earthly possession. Jesus said, the life of a man consisted not in the abundance of the things that he has. Amen. Are you all here or you go home? You look very tired. Please sit up. All right. Can you sit up? You look very, very tired. A lot of people are sleeping. Okay. It's not good to sleep when preaching is going on. Because what we are saying is that what we are saying is not important. All right. So please sit up and receive the word of God. The word of God is very important. Paul said in Acts chapter 20, verse 22, and now, brethren, I commit you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to keep you and to give you an inheritance amongst all them that are sanctified. So the word of God is able to keep you, and the word of God is able to give you an inheritance. Hallelujah. Amen. The word of God is very, very, very important in our life. So, I am saying that it's very important for all of us here in the global family to be concerned about standing with our pastor, Dr. Ampiah-Kwofi, to help him to expand the frontiers of this church, to affect many, many communities, many, many towns, many, many villages, many, many cities, many, many countries across our world. Hallelujah. Now, unfortunately, the church, especially the charismatic church, has been seriously bedeviled with a disease called disloyalty. Hallelujah. In 2011, I did a very pioneering research work on the charismatic church in Ghana. And Pastor Kwanza, 70% of all the charismatic churches in Ghana have been affected by disloyalty. It's not talk. This research, the evidence is there. Do you see? But can you imagine trying to build your house, and then each time you lay the blocks, five courses, then somebody comes to break it down and take three courses of the blocks to go and build his own house. Then you start again. Then you raise it up to seven courses. Then somebody comes. Do you understand it? Either in the morning or the afternoon or at night, and breaks it down and carries four courses. You will never be able to build a successful house. Hallelujah. We will never be able to build a great denomination, a strong denomination, a powerful denomination that can make a permanent spiritual impact in our country and outside our country if we don't stick together. Hallelujah. So loyalty talks about faithfulness. Of faithfulness, and the aim of us being loyal is so that we can be together and build something powerful together. Can I have an amen? Hallelujah. Amen. Global revival ministries are suffering from a lot of disloyalty. A lot of the people that Dr. Ampiah-Kwofi raised up and trusted with churches, with missions, have been disloyal to him. That's why I keep on, you know, getting excited when I see the pastors that I see here. At least, you know, in the last couple of years that I've associated with this church, you know, people like Pastor Kwansan, Pastor David, Pastor John, you know, Pastor Arnold, and the rest have been here for many, many years. And I'm sure there are so many other pastors. But there were earlier people. Huh? Yes. Who just took off. Amen. You had a prophet in this church. Didn't you have a prophet in this church? Huh? Who the man of God trusted with a whole service. He just took off. Is it so? You realize that. You realize that. If we continue that way, if we continue, Paul said, if I build against the thing that I've destroyed, I make myself a transgressor. Amen. So this afternoon, I want to teach you on a subject that I'm calling lessons on loyalty. Lessons on loyalty. At the end of this time, your understanding of loyalty is going to become very, very strong. Hallelujah. In 1 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 2, please turn your Bible with me. I hope you have Bibles at church, because these days Christians don't bring Bibles to church. We have made ourselves projector Christians. Amen. 1 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 2. 1 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 2. Or you can even start with verse 1. Let a man so account of us as of the ministers of Christ and of stewards of the mysteries of God. Amen. Hallelujah. Let a man so account of us as of the ministers of Christ and stewards of the mysteries of God. Verse 2. Moreover, it is required in stewards that a man be found faithful. Now, take note of the word steward. What does it mean? It's a person who manages another's property or financial affairs. One who administers anything as the agent of another or others. A person who has charge of the household of another. An employee who has charge of table, wine, servants, etc. So you see that the scripture is saying that as pastors and as Christians, we are stewards to whom the mysteries of God have been committed. Lift up your right hand. Say, I'm a steward of the Lord. A steward is somebody to whom something has been committed to manage, to administer, to take care of. Hallelujah. Amen. So you and I, we are stewards of the gospel of Jesus Christ. The Lord has committed the preaching of the gospel, the raising up of churches, the evangelization of the world, and everything that has gotten to do with the kingdom of Jesus Christ. The Lord has committed it to us. We are stewards. And God is saying that one of the things that he requires, demands, expects from a steward, from us as pastors and church workers and church members, is faithfulness. Look at it. Moreover, it is required. Take note of the word required. It is required, which means that it is a requirement. It is a qualification. Hallelujah. So see, it is required in steward that a man be found faithful. Wow. So God is saying that he wants you and I, as church workers, as branch pastors, as associate pastors, as members of the church, as leaders of the church, to exhibit faithfulness. Hallelujah. Can I please ask everybody to stand? Please, everybody stand. Everybody, please. Everybody stand. All right? Please, everybody stand. Everybody, please. Can I have everyone to stand, please? Hallelujah. Huh? Now, one of the things that is lacking in our world is faithfulness. Many people are not faithful. And the word faithful means fidelity. It means dependability. It means constance. It means always there. It also means loyal. One of the definitions of the word faithful is the word loyal. And God is saying that it is a requirement. He expects all of us to be loyal, to be faithful, to be dependable. We should not be like people who change all the time. Why? Why? Because the nature of God is not to change. The nature of God, in Malachi chapter 3, verse 6, he said, I am the Lord and I change not. I change not. Amen. I get what I'm saying. God does not change. And as people of God, the Bible expects us to be like God. Ephesians chapter 1. Chapter 5 and verse 1. Be ye followers of God as dear children. We are supposed to follow God. We are supposed to be like God. We must have the nature of God. Hallelujah. I get what I'm saying. And the nature of God is faithfulness. So, when somebody is not faithful, when somebody is not loyal, the person is exhibiting the nature of Satan. Hallelujah. So we must be loyal. We must be faithful. As stewards. But there's a lot of unfaithfulness. Of unfaithfulness. Even in the church. There are Christian husbands who are unfaithful to their Christian wives in the church. And you see, I'm using Christian so that you don't think that I'm talking about people in the world. I'm talking about in the church. Hey. We are just like the people in the world, though. We are just like the people in the world. I tell you. Yeah. But we must be different. Hello? We must be different. The Bible said that we are a peculiar people. Huh? Yeah. There's a scripture in Titus chapter 2 and verse 11. Put it up. Hallelujah. Are you here or you go home? Titus chapter 2, from verse 11. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation had appeared unto all men, teaching us that, denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. Hallelujah. Continue. Looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior Jesus Christ. Continue. Who gave himself, watch this, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. Jesus gave himself to redeem us so that he will prepare unto himself a peculiar people. There is a difference between a Christian and an unbeliever in every area of our lives. In every area of our life. Yeah. So, one of the end time evils that the Bible predicts is that people will be covenant breakers. That means unfaithful to their covenant. Now, in the church, people get married and after 6 months, they are divorced. I mean, the covenant that they made, does not matter at all. It does not matter. But the psalmist asked in Psalm 15, Lord, who ascend to the holy hill? And who come to the holy tabernacle? And one of the requirements is that he that sweareth to his head and changeth not. He that sweareth to his head and changeth not. You see, that is faithfulness. That is loyalty. That is dependability. Hallelujah. So I'm trying to let you understand that the doctrine of loyalty is biblical. It's biblical. Hallelujah. In Luke 16, Jesus said, if you have not been faithful with another man's business, who will give you your own? If you have not been faithful, that is why pastors who become disloyal, they don't do well. Because you see, you are not faithful with another person's branch. How will you, now that you have also stolen the branch and you have gone, how do you expect to do well? Hallelujah. So, loyalty is very important. And I want to teach you about certain principles, certain lessons that you need to understand about the subject of loyalty. Amen. Amen. Are you here? I've gone home. We are all standing to preach. Yeah. Hallelujah. Number one, loyalty demands full persuasion. Loyalty demands full persuasion. Hallelujah. Amen. Loyalty. Now listen, if you are going to be loyal to somebody, one of the things that you must understand is that you must be fully persuaded about the person. If you are going to be loyal to your pastor, to your leader. All right? You need to be fully persuaded. Full persuasion. In other words, there must be no doubts in your mind about a person. It is very important. You cannot be loyal to somebody that you doubt. You understand it? You cannot be loyal to somebody that you doubt. Yeah. That is why young people who are not married, listen to me. Try and keep your premarital relationship pure and holy in the sight of the Lord. You see, because if you sleep together during that relationship, when you marry and one of you travels, you always in your mind think that it is possible. It is possible. How many of you understand what I'm talking about? It is possible. It is possible that she will go and do it somewhere, or he will go and do it somewhere. And the reason why your mind is working that way is because of your past experience. But if the relationship was strong, in the midst of temptations, you resisted it. Then now, after the marriage, you say that this guy, I know him. I know him. Even if he's tempted, he will stay focused. So you are fully persuaded. Hallelujah. Amen. So that is the first lesson on loyalty. That loyalty demands full persuasion. Please take your seat. Hallelujah. Now, in the ministry, there's a lot of accusation. There's a lot of accusation. Pastors are accused all the time of so many things. And it affects the church members. When you hear that your pastor is stealing the money, when you hear that your pastor is misusing the church finances, when you hear that your pastor is sleeping with members of the church, when you hear, it affects you. And it affects your commitment or your faithfulness to your pastor. That is why you must be persuaded of your pastor. You must be persuaded. So that when issues like that are coming up, you say, no, not this one. Not this one. Not this one. Look at 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 14. In the things which thou hast learned and has been assured of. So Paul was telling Timothy, I want you to continue in the things that you have learned, the things that I've taught you, the things that you have been assured of. You see, Timothy was a son in ministry to Paul. So Paul said, look, I want you, the things that you have learned of me, the things that you have heard, the things that you have been assured of, continue in them. And he explained to Timothy why. He said, knowing of whom thou hast lent them. Give me the NIV, please. The NIV. NIV. All right, NIV. Okay, you don't have it. He said, knowing of whom thou hast it. He said, because you have learned these things of me. He said, because I have taught you these things. And because you know me. In fact, when you go to verse 10, you can go to verse 10 of the same verse. Go to verse 10. There were so many things that Paul told Timothy, you know about me. He said, but thou hast fully known my doctrine, my manner of life, my purpose, my faith, long suffering, charity, patience. All right? Continue. My persecutions, my afflictions. He said, there are so many things. You know my doctrine. You know my manner of life. In other words, you know my behavior. You know my lifestyle. You know what I stand for. And because you know all these things, that is why I'm telling you that continue in the things that I've taught you because you know me. In other words, being fully persuaded is because of the fact that you know me. Hallelujah. I get what I'm saying. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. One time, a member of a church reported that he has seen one of the associate pastors at a nightclub with a lady. So she reported this matter to the head pastor. And the head pastor thought about what the lady had said for a while. And within a short while, he dismissed it. He dismissed it. Why? Because he knew this pastor. He knew his integrity. He had known him for years. And therefore, he was fully persuaded of his character and manner. And knew that this was not somebody who could do something like this. It is very important as we are building this denomination to be persuaded of our leaders. Very, very important. Because I tell you, one of the greatest weapons that Satan uses to destroy churches is accusations. When Satan was cast down to heaven, heaven rejoiced, but they say woe to the earth. Look at Revelation chapter 12 from verse 10. Revelation chapter 12 and from verse 10. And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, look at it. Now is come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night. When Satan was cast down, they said the accuser of the brethren is cast down. Alright, continue. And they overcame him with the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto death. Yes? Therefore, now look at it, everybody. When Satan was cast down to earth, listen. Therefore, rejoice, ye heavens, and ye that dwell in them. When Satan was cast down, all right, there was an announcement. Rejoice, rejoice, you who dwell in heaven. But look at it. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and of the sea. For the devil is come down unto you, having great wrath, because he knoweth that he had but a short time. When Satan was cast down, heaven was rejoicing, but they said, woe unto it. Why? Because the accuser of the brethren. One of the most painful things you can experience in your life is accusations. Accusations. When you know that what the people are saying is not the case. And you see, Satan can come into the church and accuse the pastors. Accuse the pastors. And accuse the leader. It is an evil spirit. It's a demonic thing that is released into churches. That is why we must be persuaded fully. We must have full persuasion of the people that we are following. Clap your hands for Jesus, somebody. Hallelujah. Paul said in 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 12, he said, wherefore I am not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed, and I am persuaded. Paul said, I am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day. He said, I am persuaded. Paul was persuaded of his work with God, of the power of God, of the goodness of God. Hallelujah. Now look at me, everybody. Be persuaded about God as you enter into 2016. You might have gone through a lot of challenges this year, but it doesn't mean that God is a lie. Hallelujah. For God is not a man that he should lie. Neither is he the son of man that he should repent. Has he said it, and will he not do it? Hallelujah. He said, every word that I send forth will not come back unto me void, but it shall accomplish in the matter for which I send it. Amen. Jesus said, heaven and earth shall pass away, but not a jot, not a tittle of the word of God shall pass away. Forever, O God, thy word is settled in heaven. For the flowers shall fade, and the wither shall wither, but the word of the Lord our God standeth sure. God is somebody that you can be persuaded of. A lot of Christians are not persuaded of God. We shift with the winds. When you are going through challenges, you shift. Amen. When everything is going on well, you embrace God fully. But you see, the people who walked with God and did exploits, people like Abraham, people like Isaac, people like Jacob, people like Joseph and Daniel and Moses and Elijah and Elisha, they were fully persuaded of God. They were fully persuaded of the power of God. They were fully persuaded of the faithfulness of God. Look at Elijah. He stood as one man against 400 prophets of Baal and contested against them. He contested against them for the name of God to be established in the land. At the end, during the evening, when they had cried unto their God and nothing had happened and God is standing, do you know what he did? He said, set up the altar. Tell the young prophets, set up the altar. And when they did it, he said something very strange. He said, pour water on it. Pour water. When you want wood to catch fire, you don't pour water on the wood. But I said, pour water. And I'm sure that the prophets who were not persuaded of God, they came to me and said, man of God, we don't know whether you have high fever or something is happening to you. We don't pour water when we want fire to come. I said, pour water. The whole altar was soaked totally, completely with blood water. Totally. Leaking all over. Why? Because he was fully persuaded of God. Be fully persuaded of this church. Hello? Be fully persuaded of your leader. Hallelujah. Yes. I thought Ampiah-Kwofi has been with you all these years. What type of man is he? Is he a thief? Is he a thief? Now, if he's a thief, analyze it carefully. What thief would put up this type of church building? Thieves don't do this. Thieves think about themselves. They think about themselves. I mean, whenever I enter this place, I see the sacrifice of a man. I see a man of faith. Most pastors would like to plant a church where there are people. You understand? So to move out of the city and come to a place where almost there's nobody, that is a man of faith. You must see a man of faith. You must see a man of power. You must see a man that loves God, that wants to advance the kingdom of God. So when somebody comes to you and say he's a thief, you look at the person, you don't know who you are talking about. Hallelujah. Amen. Be persuaded. When you are persuaded, when your heart is established, when your heart is established, you don't allow the devil room into your life. Hallelujah. Are you here or you go home? Huh? So, loyalty. The first lesson on loyalty is that loyalty demands full persuasion. Lift up your right hand. What is the first lesson on loyalty? I want to hear it from you. Loyalty demands what? Say it again. No, the whole statement. Amen. There's a saying that, can there be smoke without fire? Can there be smoke without fire? In other words, as far as there's a smoke, there must be fire. How many of you understand that? In other words, once the thing is said, there must be some truth in it. But I'll tell you that, go and find out whether there's a real fire there. Because for all you know, the fire is 5 miles away. But the winds have blown the smoke to this place. That is why you are seeing the smoke here. It doesn't mean that there's fire here. But the winds have blown the smoke to this place. Wow. Be persuaded. Now, if you want people to be persuaded of you, all right, let me show you one or two things that you must do. Number one, you must practice openness. Pastors, practice openness. Don't be a mysterious person. Practice openness in the area of your finances. Yes. The people who are close to you, very close to you, who are working with you, tell them how you get your finances. You see, sometimes the reason why pastors come under fire is because we behave too much in a mysterious way. We have come to park this shiny car. We are asking you, why did you get this? Oh, God has provided. We know God has provided, but how did he provide? You understand? At least the people who are very close to you, tell them about it. It's transparency. Whenever there's a problem, there's accusations, you know, somebody is saying something about you, it is the people who are close to you who will defend you. But what about if they don't know? What about if they don't know? So be open about your finances. Yes. Be open about your finances. Amen? Not everybody. You don't stand in public. But there are people who are around you. Because you don't work in a void. You work with people. Number two. Be open about your vision. Your vision. People will follow you when they understand what is it that you are trying to do. That is why Dr. Ampiah-Kwofi brings us here every year, even though the place is not completed. So that we all will realize what is it that he's trying to do. How many of you understand what he's trying to do here? How many of you understand it? Let me see your hand. Yes. So we cannot understand. Look, our pastor is trying to put up a permanent church building. And what a great church building. I mean, this is one of the greatest church buildings I've seen. And by the grace of God, I've traveled around for a while. God has given me the grace to travel around for a while. I was passing through an airport in a very big country. The immigration officer looked at me and said, "Are you a diplomat?" When he saw the passports and the visas all over the different places. So I have seen church buildings. This is one of the most fantastic. I mean, when we finish this church building, people are going to come from everywhere to come and see. But you see, that is why we are here. That is why even when it's not completed, he brings us here so that we can see what it is that he's trying to do. So be open about your vision. So don't say, "Oh, we'll see. The Lord has said certain things. So we'll see how." Always, you are too mysterious. You are too mysterious. You are too mysterious. When God anointed Joshua after the death of Moses to take over and lead the people, that is when God spoke to him. He said, "Step into the land. Be courageous. Don't be afraid. In the land that you step, that is what I'll give to you." He spoke to him about so many things. When he finished, Joshua came to the people and rehearsed everything in their ears. And do you know what the people said? They told him, "Everything that God said we should do, we'll do it." They said, "If there's anybody here who will not follow you, we will kill the person. Kill them." Look at Joshua chapter 1, verse 16. Joshua chapter 1, verse 16. Amen. Hallelujah. "And they answered Joshua, saying, 'All that thou commanded us, we will do. And whithersoever thou sendest us, we will go.'" Continue. "According as we hearken unto Moses in all things, so will we hearken unto thee. Only the Lord thy God be with thee as he was with Moses. Whosoever," look at it, "whosoever he be that doth rebel against thy commandments and will not hearken unto thy words in all that thou commandest him, he shall be put to death. Only be strong and be of good courage." When he explained the vision to them, they said, "We'll follow you. And anybody who will try to step this vision, we will rise up and kill the people." Yeah. You see, this is what should be happening in our churches. When we find rebels, rebellious pastors, rebellious church members, rebellious church workers, we the church workers should stand up. We the members should stand up and say, "Listen, you can't do this in our church here." Yeah. How is it that associate pastors are able to steal the church members and break away? How is it possible? How is it possible? How is it possible? Huh? How is it possible? That is it, Pastor Bright, huh? Yes. If Dr. Ampiah-Kwofi leads Pastor Bright here for 6 months because he's doing some mission somewhere, some crusades, you know, and then Pastor Bright now begins to say, "Listen, I think it's about time, you know, some of us, we moved on." And he begins to say this in the church. You see, the church members and the loyal members, you should rise up and say, "What did you say? What did you say? Please don't speak like that. Next time you speak like that, we'll carry you out of the church. We'll carry you out of the church. We'll carry you out of the church. And we, the pastors, must be speaking like that." Ask my pastors. I stand at my cathedral and I tell them all the time. I said, in the day that I'll stand here to say that Lighthouse Chapel International Korle-Gonno Cathedral is no more Lighthouse. And that now it's International Church of Believers Associated, Anointed Charismatic Prophetic Apostles Missions of God, with Miracles and Signs and Wonders Church. That is the day that you should all come and carry me out of the church. No church member here, either in this branch or in any of the branches from which we have come from, should be stolen. Don't allow yourself for a pastor to steal you. That pastor there, that church is not his church. The real pastor that we all have in Global Revival Ministries is only one pastor. His name is called Reverend Dr. Robert Ampiah-Kwofi. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Listen, if you follow a rebellious pastor, you'll be destroyed. If you follow a rebellious pastor, you'll be destroyed. When Absalom drove away his father and rebelled against King David, the Bible said that 200 young men fled with him and followed him out of the simplicity of their mind. And all of them were killed. All of them were killed. And you see, let me tell you something. Pastors, branch pastors. Branch pastors. And those of who are workers in the branch churches. There's something that you must know. The anointing with which we are doing that work is the anointing that God has removed. Not removed. Shed from Dr. Ampiah-Kwofi and put on your head. And you are able to minister and build that church based on that anointing. Immediately you move out. Immediately you move out, you're on your own. That anointing stays. Yes. So that is why you see that the pastor begins to struggle. One pastor, orangulized. Do you understand orangulized? A rebellious pastor is called an orangutan. It's called what? It's called what? Orangutan. The short form is orangu. An orangu is a rebellious person. Hey. And this afternoon we are killing all orangus from the church. There are people who sit in the choir, they sit in the ashes, prayer ministry, and they are rebellious to the pastor. When your pastor says we are doing this, you'll be memories of why are we shut your mouth up. You are talking too much. No, check by yourself. Why is the person? Check. Ask the person. Are you the one? Are you the one that the bishop is talking about? Huh? A pastor took, look, he was one of the most organized rebels that we have seen. I tell you, a church that had 200 members, when he left, the church was reduced to 50. And then, apart from that church, some churches around, they affected all of them. Yeah. But you see, what did he know was that everything he knew about ministry, he had learned it from Lighthouse Chapel. So when they met the first few times, Lighthouse, we have a way of sharing the grace. Those of you who have visited Lighthouse before, we have a way of sharing the grace. So when he said, let's share the grace, to his surprise, all the members share the grace, even though he said this was a new church, according to the Lighthouse grace. So he looked at it and said, it's okay. Let's share this way for a while until we think of a way of changing it. You see, you are exposing the fact that everything that you know has come from. I don't want to go into his story. That's another matter. But all rebels will be executed. Check the Bible. Who are the rebels? Lucifer. He was cast down on it. Absalom. He rebelled against his father. He was executed. Adonijah. He usurped powers to become the king. He was executed. Ahithophel, who was David's right-hand man, who rebelled against him and joined the camp of Absalom. His counsel was turned into foolishness. He became so depressed that he killed himself. He was executed. Shimei. There was a man called Shimei. When King David was running out of the city, he saw King David and took stones and threw them against him. And the king's people said, let's go and kill him. He said, no. The Lord has allowed him to do that to him. He was executed. Judas Iscariot was executed. The end of all rebel is executed. Look, this pastor who left, soon he had all kinds of problems. The people that he took with also rose up. And they also orangulized him. And one of the chief people that he used to orangulize, one of them, and he said, watch, listen to me. Because judgment of God does not come promptly. Do you see? Men think that God is a weak God, but God is not a weak God. Yeah. Watch what you are doing in your church. Watch. Don't destroy God's church. Don't destroy God's church. There are church members, you criticize your pastors. You insult them, you remember, you sit in your home and you criticize the pastor. He's trying to do his best. Now listen to me. The pastor is not perfect. He's a human being. The pastor is called a man of God. A man. But he's also of God. But he's a man. With all the weaknesses, all the frailties, all the problems of a man. Hallelujah. I get what I'm saying. So don't kill him. Allow your pastor to make mistakes. He will grow out of it. There are so many mistakes that I did as a young pastor that today I will not do. I'd rather use it to teach my young pastors. Yeah. Yeah. Amen. Wow. Are you here or you've gone home? So I want those of us in Global Revival Ministries to be persuaded of what is happening here. Amen. If you want the best church in the world, we are persuaded that the best church in the world is not Lighthouse Chapel International, it's not Christian Action Faith, it's not Central. The best church in the world is Global Revival Ministries. We must be persuaded. Yeah. There are some of you here. Instead of supporting the work that Dr. Ampiah-Kwofi is doing here and the pastors are doing, even in your branches, you don't do that. Some of you, you pay your tithe to other churches, to another man of God somewhere. Yeah. Yeah, pastors, one of the things that you should know is that many of your members, apart from you, they have other pastors. Oh, yeah. Yeah. They have other pastors. You can't ask a question when I'm preaching. Who taught you that? You don't ask questions when a pastor is preaching, please. Hello? The demons are reacting to the preaching. Just like in Mark 1. Hello? Are you here? Are you here? Go home. Wow. Now, so be fully persuaded. Let your heart be here. Amen. Let us support our leader in the thing that he's doing. Amen. Let's back him up. Let's strengthen his hand. Let's hold his hand and say, we believe in you. We believe in you. We believe in you. Go ahead. We will help you. In your branch, wherever you came from, help the pastor there. Help him. Pray for him. Strengthen him. Encourage him. Be persuaded. Wow. How many of you understand it? What is the first lesson on loyalty? I want to hear all of you. Lift up your right hand and say it. What's the first lesson? Loyalty what? Demands for persuasion. Clap your hands for Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Number two. Your loyalty must be to the higher authority. Your loyalty must be to the higher authority. Look at me. This is a very important lesson. I'm teaching you lessons on loyalty so that your heart will be established. The second lesson you must know about loyalty is that your loyalty must always be to the higher authority. Now, in every institution, there will be different levels of authority. Amen. Now, if I take my church, all right, we have cell leaders. They are the first level of authority. Then above them, we have senior cell leaders. Then above them, we have pastors. Then I head the pastors. And my head is Bishop Dad. And Bishop Dad's head is God. How many of you understand that? You understand it? And that is how it is. So, when the issue of the question of loyalty arises, what must you do? Your loyalty must always be the person who is higher. Higher. So, my cell leaders, my members must be loyal to my cell leaders. My cell leaders must be loyal to the pastors that I've placed over them. Because my pastors in my church, they are very powerful. They control a lot of people. Some control 500, 400. I mean, so many people. So if that pastor decides to be disloyal, it's a problem. So my cell leaders must be loyal to the pastors. And the pastors must be loyal to me. And I must be loyal to Bishop Dad. That's how it is. And Bishop Dad must be loyal to God. Now, as a member of the church, you must be loyal to your pastor. But your pastor also has a head, which is the general overseer. So when we take Global Revival, all our branches, we have pastors. And the pastors take the authority from the district pastors. Is that also? From district pastors. And the district pastors are all under the GO, the general overseer. So when the question of loyalty arises in the church, what are you going to do? This is why we must remember this lesson. My loyalty is to the higher authority. So for example, all right, where do we have some of the branches? Asamankase. Yes. Where's my Asamankase brother? Pastor, is he around? What's his name? Huh? Reverend Jones, my friend from Asamankase. If Reverend Jones now said to say that the church at Asamankase, or Pastor Kwanza, do you have a church? Where? Taifa, Pastor Kwanza. Say that now the church at Taifa He wants to change it into his church. He's tired of all this global thing. Doesn't want to be part of global again. So he wants to carry all the members from Taifa. Where are some of you? Are some of you here? Lift up your hand. Is anybody from Taifa? Huh? Yeah. Is somebody there? And there's somebody there. There's somebody there. Listen. He wants to carry all of you now and now form, and you see, Orangus. The names of their churches are very close to the names of where they came from. Yeah. And Orangu left Lighthouse, Lighthouse Chapel International, and then called his name Powerhouse Chapel International. No, real thing. Yeah. And Orangu left our church. Okay. And one of the branches that we have is the First Love Church, which is pastored by Bishop Dad himself. Now, when he went, he also went to call and said, First Love Church International. Yeah, it's there. It's there. Yeah. Yes. Bishop Dad's crusades are called Healing Jesus Crusades. Then he has got to form a crusade called a Healing Jesus. Very close. About 2 weeks ago, I sent some pastors to him. I said, go and tell him that he must change the names. I told him, go there and tell him that he must change the names. Yeah. Maybe Pastor Kwansa says that now the Taifa Church is no more global revival. It's global resurrection ministries international. Yeah. That is it. What are you members at Taifa going to do? You see, you love him. You are loyal to him. But at that particular time, you will remember that, but this is not your church. You are only a branch, pastor. You were sent to start this church. You were raised up. Somebody appointed you. We can't follow you. Our loyalty will now move from above you and go to the higher authority, which is Papa. How many of you understand it? This time I'm not here to make you happy. I'm here to teach you. Yeah. You see, it is because these things are not taught in churches. That is why our churches cannot have other places. Yeah. Look, if we understand loyalty, and you cannot build a mega church without loyalty. You can't. Because you see that every time somebody is sent to start a branch, the person takes over. Every time. But we should be able to be one big global revival ministry families worldwide. Worldwide. By the grace of God, that is the example that we are experiencing in the Lighthouse Chapel International. Yeah. I mean, when I say this one went and this one, it's very few. Few and far in between. Ew. The Lighthouse Chapel International, as of now, is close to 2,000 branches worldwide in over 72 countries. It's one big family. One big family. This November, we brought the church workers from around the world. Can you imagine? Around the world, they bought their tickets and came to Ghana. We gathered leaders, church workers, around about 4,000. They bought tickets from the Caribbean islands, from the Caribbean, from Australia, from different places, Francophone countries, and they came. That is possible only when the pastors, the members, and church leaders have been taught to be loyal, to be faithful to the vision. Listen. Every ministry is peculiar. Every ministry is peculiar. Every time I see that Ampiah-Kwofi, I just get amazed. What an anointed man of God. There is a contrast between him naturally and when he mounts the stage. The man is quiet. He doesn't talk. So humble. Doesn't pick a fight with anybody. I've never heard it before. I've known him for over 20 years. Closely. I've known his wife. I always always see her smiling, happy. You understand that? But when the man picks the mic, something changes about his life. There's a power. There's a grace. There's something that comes and changes the man's demeanor and everything. That is the grace of God. And when you have such a person as your leader, you must love him. You must stand by him. You must support him and not kill him. You are not clapping your hands. You are a suspect. I want to see the suspects. I want to see the suspects. Yeah. Last Sunday night when I came here, I don't know whether all of you were here. And I said, let's bless him with an offering. Some people were sitting down. I took note of that. I mean, you don't have money to bless your man of God, even 5 Ghana cedis. You are some way. You are very some way. You don't deserve this gift of God. Yeah. And you see, let me tell you something. Don't wait until Pastor Kwansa is no more your pastor at Taifa before you honor him. Today, as he's living there, honor him. Honor him now. Bless him. Encourage him. Give him gifts. Support him. Wow. So your loyalty is to the higher authority. Yes. Now, the day that Bishop died, will stop following God is the day that I'll stop following him. Why? Because at that time, my loyalty is not to him. My loyalty is to God. I love him. I appreciate him. I'm always happy to be close with him. Just last Monday, I was with him. But the day that he will deviate and now say that as Lighthouse pastors, he's given us the authority apart from our wives to marry 3 more and have 7 more girlfriends around, is the day that I say, no, I can't follow you. Because loyalty must be the higher authority. And God's word says that a bishop must be a man of one wife. Is it not amazing? You see, it is the lack of understanding of this principle. That is why church members follow bad pastors. What did Paul say in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 1? He said, follow me as I follow Christ. Follow me. Follow me as I follow Christ. Come, brother. This is Christ. This is Christ. This is Christ. Come. 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 We are following Christ. Please go. We are following him. Follow me as I follow Christ. Wow. I get what I'm saying. So now this is Christ. This is our pastor who is following. And these are the church members. So they should follow him for as long as he's following Christ. Anytime he stops following Christ and he deviates this way, they should leave him alone, but they should continue to follow Christ. Clap your hands for Jesus and give Jesus a shout of victory. Thank you. Do you understand that? Now, somewhere, I think in the 70s, there was a pastor, he was called Jim Jones, an American pastor. When he started, and watch out, pastors, we need to be loyal to God, to our calling, to the word of God. Don't let us twist the word around, pastors. Don't let us twist the word around for our own personal ambitions, aspirations, and for our own advantage. Amen. And you see, the church members, because they don't know the word of God. You see, that is why pastors, don't stand in the congregation and just quote one scripture after the other and other is good. But the rest, they don't know the scripture. Put the scripture there, let them see it. I always tell my members, watch it. Watch it. Write it down. Look at it when you go. Be like the Christians, the Berean Christians. Acts chapter 17 and verse 1. The Bible says that for these were more noble than those in Thessalonica, in that they received the word of God, the readiness of mind, and they sent the scriptures daily to see whether those things were so. When you come to church and you go home, you must open the scripture. What my pastor taught me, is it the word of God? Is it the word of God? Because Jesus said that during this time, the end times, false teachers will rise up. Amen? Huh? But it is because the church members don't understand this. That is why they follow wrong teachings. That is why they rebel. Hallelujah. That is why they follow rebellion. They follow rebellion. Hey, never follow a rebellious pastor. Lift up your right hand. Say, I shall never follow a rebellious pastor. One day. When I say one day, one day. One day. A certain pastor orangulize his head pastor. Yes. And went to set up another church. Unfortunately for this head pastor, the members in the church, you don't know these teachings that I'm giving to you this afternoon. How many of you have been blessed by the teachings? Yes. We are killing demons from the church. Yes. Hallelujah. So a lot of the members followed him, and this pastor went to set up a church. You know what happened? How many of you want to know what happened? How many of you really want to know? Okay, only two people, so I won't tell you. No, only two people want to know. How many of you want to know? You want to know? Stand to your feet and lift up your two hands. All right. So that I'll tell you. Hey. Wow. Pastor Bright, you will not believe it. When they followed him and started the church, he got an opportunity to go and preach in America. This Orangu pastor. Rebels are called hot. Are called hot. Orangus. Yeah. Amen. Orangulization is the process. Orangulization is a process. To orangulize is the verb. A verb is a doing word. To orangulize. Oranguism is a concept. Orangulizers are the teachings that kill orangutans. So I'm giving you an orangulizer. Welcome, Reverend Kwashi. Happy to see people like this who have been standing by this plan of God for years. Hello? He got an opportunity. Somebody invited him to go and preach in America. When he went, he sent a message that he will come after 2 weeks. You will wait. Getting to inside, you went, oh, God is doing great things, so God has opened another door. So 4 weeks. Before the 4 weeks could end, he said, hey, God is even doing greater things. More doors have been opened. Can you imagine that up to today that I'm speaking? He hasn't come back. He hasn't come back. The church collapsed and the sheep scattered. Listen, listen. One of the reasons why rebellion, you understand it, orangulization is evil, demonic, wicked, is because often it scatters the sheep. Listen, pastors, we are not supposed to scatter the sheep. We are supposed to gather the sheep. Jesus said, whosoever gathereth not with me is not of me, and whosoever does not gather with me scattereth. And church members, we should not follow scatterers. We are supposed to gather the sheep. Now, one person, one of the members who followed him, I'm still telling you about the story, joined another church. And when he joined that church, after some time, another pastor in that church rose up and broke away and tried to convince some of the members to follow him. One of the people that he tried to convince was this guy. Do you remember this guy who came from the pastor, the American pastor? Yes. So when he went to see him, then the guy told him that, you can't fool me two times. You cannot fool me two times. He said, oh, why? I'm just, you can't fool me to that. So then he explained to him. He said, look, once upon a time, I went to follow an orangu like yourself. When he went to America, he never came. Today you are coming for me again. It will never work. May that be your position. May that be your conviction. May that be your declaration. May that be your response to an orangu. Lift up your voice and give the Lord a shout. Hallelujah. Wow. So your loyalty must be always to the higher authority. Yeah. See my pastors here, they love me. But I can tell you that their system is infused with orangulizers. If I try to move away, you're just a bishop. Bye bye. Our real leader. Yeah. You see, a good attitude and a good heart for a branch pastor to have is always to point the people to the founder of the church. Yes. Many rebellious branch pastors, they don't say anything about the founder of the church. Yes, they don't. They don't. They don't. Yes. You tell them to appreciate you, but what about the founder? During the founder's birthday, you should rise up and say, look, we are living here. Do you have a branch? Where? La Paz. We are at La Paz today because Reverend Dr. Ampiah-Kwofi sent me here. He selected me out of congregation, laid his hands on me, asked the people to call me pastor, sent me here, has supported me to start to build this La Paz branch of Global Revival. Today is his birthday. As a church, let us give an offering and go and give it to him to appreciate it. Yes. But a rebellious pastor will be thinking inside, monkey the work, babu the chop. And he should bless the pastor's wife. The ladies in the churches, your real love is to show. Don't just say, hey, Mama Brefa, we love you, we love you, we love you, love you. You'll be blessing her in your kitchen. Shower her with gifts. Bless her, come to her, sow into her life. Say good things to her. Hey. I shouldn't say it. I will say it. How many of you believe that we are being healed? Amen. What is the first lesson on loyalty? Lift up your right hand and say it. What's the first lesson? Loyalty what? Demands full persuasion. Second lesson is what? Loyalty is what? The higher authority. Yeah. Pastors, let me give you a secret. Anytime you find somebody doing something wrong in your church, you understand? Find out which other people also knew about it. The fact that they knew about it and they did not tell you means that they were disloyal to you. Which leads me to the third lesson on loyalty. The third lesson on loyalty. Loyalty, a loyal person does not withhold information. A loyal person does not withhold information. Hallelujah. A loyal person does not do what? I can't hear. Lift up your right hand. Say it with me. A loyal person does not withhold information. Listen. If we are in the church and something bad is being said or done, you have to let the pastor know. Or you have to let the leader in the choir. We have a choir leader who the pastor has appointed. Then you hear people who sit at their offices, at their homes, and they'll be criticizing, insulting everything that the choir leader does. Now, if you are a loyal member, you have to let him. You say, if I do that, the person will hate me. The person will hate you. I'll come to another principle. You understand it. But you are doing the right thing. Listen, pastors who steal churches, do you think that they just get up one day to do that? No, they have been planning. They have been planning. And they select the powerful members. Aish. How many of you realize that when our wives cook meat, there are different sizes soup. There are different sizes of meat in the soup. So some of the meat lumps are smaller. Some of them are big. Yes. And can you imagine that somebody comes to your house and puts his hand into your soup and takes out all the big meat and leaves you with the bones? One day, a certain senior pastor visited another senior pastor. And as he saw the wonderful things that he could see in that church, there was a table by his side. He hit it like this. And as he was hitting it, he was looking into the ceiling. And then he said, "And Kofoye, I am a dear pa. Omu ayi inkwanumu enamina. Omu ajami ndumpenkwa." Do you understand it? He was talking about his passes. His passes that he has raised up and sent into the churches, and as one after the other have orangulized him and took the members. And I'm saying that they have a way of taking the powerful members They will go with the choir leader. They will go with the present worship leader. They will go with the main financier in the church. They will go. You watch and see. Pastors, if you joke with what I'm preaching about, you are joking with your fever. Yeah. Never joke with the doctrine of loyalty and disloyalty. Pastors, never. They will kill you. You will die. Your life's work will be destroyed in just one day. Yeah. Just recently, a powerful man of God, a powerful ministry, and there was a prophet who used to minister in the church. Not what happened here. Somewhere else. Look. One day somebody came to tell him that, hey, do you know that all your powerful members are in this church? Not knowing that as the prophet was coming there, he has also started a church and directed all the powerful members there. You are an orangu. Look, how many of you realize, how many of you agree that such people are very wicked? Are they very wicked? Yeah. But their lives will be full of curses. One of the curses is that you marry your wife and another man will come and sleep with your wife. On the honeymoon bed, there'll be, on the honeymoon bed, just after you have taken your trousers and this, and there'll be a knock on the door. Another man can say, please stay aside. Go and read Deuteronomy chapter 28. Hello? So listen, when you sit in the church, as a church worker, as a church member, as an associate pastor, do you understand it? And you hear about wrong things, you must report. And of course, I am not talking about evil tale-bearing. I'm not talking about gossiping. I'm talking about godly reporting. There's a difference between godly reporting, which is scriptural, and just gossiping around. So ladies, I'm not giving you license to go and gossip. And all throughout the scriptures, you will see that this principle played out. Amen? It played out. Look at Acts chapter 23. Hallelujah. Are you here or you've gone home? Amen. Now, in Acts chapter 23, Paul had been, remember Paul went to Jerusalem with some people and they wanted him to circumcise the people. They even did it. But somebody caused an uproar, there was confusion. They wanted to beat up Paul, kill him, and he was arrested by the Roman soldiers and kept in safety. Now, look at verse 12. Acts chapter 23 from verse 12. And when it was day, certain of the Jews banded together and bound themselves under a curse, saying that they would neither eat nor drink till they had killed Paul. And there were more than 40 who had made this conspiracy. And they came to the chief priests and elders and said, we have bound ourselves under a great curse that we will eat nothing until we have slain Paul. Now therefore, ye with the council signify to the chief captain that he bring him down unto you tomorrow, as though ye would inquire something more perfectly concerning him. And we, or ever he come near, are ready to kill him. Are ready to kill him. How many of you are following the story? So some people, about 40 plus, decided that we will kill Paul. They curse upon ourselves, upon themselves to kill. There are people who are sitting in the church, all right, and the devil is using them to destroy the church through accusations, through a critical spirit, through murmuring, through divisions, all kinds of things in the church. And when you hear of such people, a loyal person, you must not withhold that information. You must come to the leader. You must come to the pastor and say, listen, this is what is happening. If you're a branch member and your pastor is trying to take over the church, you must come to the headquarters and report. Come and report. Come and see Pastor Bright. See Pastor John. Any of the senior pastors. This is what this branch pastor is trying to do. Report. Verse 16. And when Paul's sister's son heard of their lying in wait, he went and entered into the castle and told Paul. Then Paul called one of the centurions unto him and said, bring this young man unto the chief captain. Let me just cut a long story short. But because this young man went to report, went to report, they took Paul away into safety. What is the result of that? What is the result of Paul continuing to live? The result is that God used him to write half of the New Testament. You and I would never have benefited from Romans, 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, such scriptures like rejoice. I say to you again, rejoice. We will never have experienced it. Say scriptures like, be careful for nothing, but in all things, with prayer and supplication and thanksgiving, let your request be made known unto God. We will never have seen it. Say scriptures like, resist the devil and he will flee from you. We will never. We will never. Say scriptures like, we know that all things work together for good to them that love God and to them that have been called according to his purposes. We'll never have experience. Never. Then scriptures like, and now I know that my God shall supply all your needs. We'll never have experienced it. We are enjoying these scriptures. We are being encouraged by them. We are being edified by them. We are being strengthened by them because somebody reported for Paul to be kept alive, for him to be able to do the ministry that God called him to do. If you don't report bad things in the churches, your pastor will die. And all the ministry that your pastor has been ordained to do will be cut off. How many of you can understand it? Yes. Yes. In 1 Corinthians, in the church, there were arguments. Look at verse 11. There were divisions in the church. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 11. And somebody called Chloe reported to Paul, for it had been declared unto me of you, my brethren, by them which are of the house of Chloe, that there are contentions among you. It has been reported. It has been reported. It has been reported. You must report things that are going on in the church. There are treasurers who steal the money. Yes, there are treasurers who steal the money. There are ushers who steal the money. One day, a man of God met an usher from another church. He said, oh, how is life? So life is very good. So what do you mean? So, oh, these days I'm very rich, I'm okay. What work do you do? So, every Sunday I get some money. Every Sunday, the offerings that were counting, he took some. Yes. Several years ago, in our church, we had a young man who was in charge of weddings. Oh, what a marvelous person. Every Saturday, he would be there, arranging, making sure that everything was okay. Was not a pastor, just an usher. At the end of the service, when we take offerings for the couple, we package and give it to them. For years, Onale, honest brother, But as for moi, on a honest usher. But as for moi, not knowing that all over the years, the guy was a thief. When the offerings were taken for the corpus in the packaging, you select all the big notes and then the foreign currencies. Look, when the matter came up and we visited his house, dollars, pound, yes. But the question you want to ask yourself is, so nobody knew about it. Nobody had a hint about it. He never did it of anybody. Somebody knew, but there was no godly reporting. What is the effect? It destroys the church. We shouldn't allow one person to destroy the church. God's church must be greater than any human being. Whether it's your husband, whether it's your wife, whether it's your pastor, whether it's your friend, God's church, the gospel of Jesus Christ, the church of Jesus Christ is greater than everybody. Are you clapping your hands for Jesus, somebody? Yeah. In 1 Corinthians, in that same church, do you know what was happening? There was so much fornication and evil in the church that there was somebody there who was actually sleeping with his father's wife. 1 Corinthians chapter 5, look at it. Hallelujah. Aida, you go home. Hallelujah. 1 Corinthians chapter 5. Chapter 5. Chapter 5. It is reported commonly that there is fornication among you. This is 1 Corinthians. When you hear 1 Corinthians, the first letter that Paul wrote to the Corinthian church. Yeah. Hello? I hear you go home. And Paul said, I've been receiving a report that there's so much fornication. But and such fornication as is not so much as among the Gentiles, that one should have his father's wife. Continue. And you are puffed up. You are saying the church. You are puffed up. And have not rather mourned that he that had done this deed might be taken away from among you. It's a church. And you have been sitting down here feeling so proud. Church members see bad things in the church. The senior pastor is being criticized. He's being chewed from the back. He can't see everything. Look, the people who have built this building, I don't know whether they are still around, but if they are continuing, watch them carefully. Masons and this, but they are thieves. He said, how do you know? Believe me. I have built around about 30 church projects. Believe me. Believe me, the cement, instead of 10, they make it 15. The 5 is yes. The boxes of nails, the iron rods. Yes, the cement, when they mix one, they throw one outside. How many of you have experienced things like that before? Yes. 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 And sometimes the church person that the pastor has appointed to oversee the project is in leg of them. And when you see something like that, you don't report. You don't report. That is why the project takes a long time. It takes a long time. But let me tell you something. The information that you give out one day may save your life. It may save your life. when you read Esther chapter 2, you see Esther's uncle Mordecai. Mordecai, how many of you remember him? Yes. He was the one who encouraged Esther to go for the beauty contest. He was advising. There was a wicked man who tried to kill all the Jews. His name was called Haman. I don't have time. Go into the scriptures. They are there. They are there. And this man decided to plan to kill Mordecai. On the day that Mordecai was supposed to be killed, the king was looking into the archives of the kings. And he realized that, many years ago, two of the previous king's leaders, Bithan and Teresh, they got angry with him and they planned behind the scene to kill the king. And in the process, Mordecai heard about it, told Esther, who went to tell the king. And what he did was written in the annals of the king. So that night, the night before they killed him, the king was going through the history and then he saw it. He said, this man is a loyal person. He is the one who prevented the king from being assassinated. That is how come Mordecai was saved and continued to live. Listen, the bad things that you are exposing in the church, one day, those things will save your life. Yeah. For example, what I'm going to say is very serious. Listen to it. For example, if you are in charge of a building project and the workers are cutting corners, they are not mixing the concrete well. Because the concrete, you must mix it well. If you are doing structural, you are doing patches like the columns here and the beams. These are the things that are holding the building. You cannot afford to do a concrete mix of 154 or 164. You have to do like 1.5 or 113. Solid, rich concrete. That will let the thing be there for a long time. But when you take a lot of sand, you see the richness of the concrete is dependent on the number of cement in it. But you see, they'll take a lot of sand and take a small amount of cement. So when they do it, on a leg, standing there like that, but one day that structure will collapse and kill somebody. That is why you have to expose that mason, that contractor. How many of you are here? I think my time is up. My time is up. Lessons of loyalty. Number one, loyalty demands full persuasion. Number two, your loyalty must be to the higher authority. Number three, a loyal person does not withhold information. I have 7 of them. In 2 hours, I can give you only 3. I need a camp to be able to teach you everything. Hallelujah. But how many of you are blessed? How many of you are going to be loyal? Clap your hands for the Lord, somebody. Lift up your hand. What is the first lesson on loyalty? Now, let's all stand. 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 Lift up your right hand. Only your right hand. What is the first lesson on loyalty? Loyalty demands what? Full persuasion. Number two. Your loyalty is what? To the higher authority. Amen. In this church, who is the higher authority in this church? Papa. Everybody say it. Papa. Yes. And he too, God is above him. Yes. When he also deviate from God, he said, hey, Papa, we like you, but Charlie, where you have passed. I was telling you about Jim Jones. I didn't finish. Yes. He was an American pastor. He took his members from America. Can you believe? Hundreds of them into the jungles of a country called Guyana. Guyana. Normally, when you go outside our country and they ask, where do you come from? Ghana. They think you are coming from that country, Guyana. Yeah. Guyana. I've been there a couple of times. In the jungle. He put the people there and then indoctrinated them with some wild teachings to the extent that he told them that when they drank cyanide and killed themselves, they all go to be in heaven. Can you imagine? They all took cyanide and died. A few of them that survived and ran away through the storm. But you see, why was it so? Because the people did not know the word of God. Brothers and sisters, we must know the word of God. Don't let us just follow the pastors and accept everything that they say. Let's be like the Christians in Berea. We receive the word and set the scriptures. Hey, when your pastor says that he wants to pray for you to get a child, so he needs to have an all night to fill his house. Make sure that you arrive around 11 p.m. And the prayer meeting will start from 11 to 12 midnight. And between 12 midnight to 2 a.m., he has to massage you with special oil that he brought from Israel. And you too, look at your big bottles that you have removed, your big bottles. Christian sister, look at you. And you even put on G-strings and went there. With your big bottles, one here. That the pastors will massage you because you need a child. You should ask the pastor that, please, open, where's the Bible? Open. Which part of the Bible talks about this? I really want to come to your house. But please show me in the Bible. My people perish for lack of what? Knowledge. Clap your hands for Jesus. Lift up your hands. I want us to pray. Ask the Lord to give you, lift up your two hands. Ask the Lord to give you a loyal heart. I want to be faithful. I want to be a faithful person. I want to be faithful to God. I want to be faithful to my pastors, to my leaders, to my husband, to my wife, to all the levels of authority that you have placed upon me. Pastors, let us pray that we'll be loyal to the call of God, that we'll not depart from the call of God, that we'll pursue the call of God on our life, that we'll preach the gospel. Lift up your hands and pray. Lift up your two hands and pray. Lift up your two hands and pray. This is a very important time. Pray that God will heal your heart from every stain of disloyalty and unfaithfulness. In the name of Jesus. Any disloyal ideas that are brewing in your mind and brewing in your heart, ask the Lord to heal you and to deliver you from them. Lift up your hands and pray. Lift up your two hands, everybody, and pray. Yes. 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 or pray. Ask the Lord to heal you. Pray. I don't want to go the same way I came. Touch me with your hand, Jesus. Touch me with your hand. Come on.
Jesus.
Yes.
Touch me with your hand.
Lift up your hands and pray to God.
Jesus. Touch me with your hand.
Yes.
Jesus. Touch me with your hand.
Jesus. Pray. Lift up your hands and pray.
I don't wanna go the same way I came. Touch me with your hand.
Yeah. Lift up your hands, let me pray for you. Father, what a great gift you have given unto us in this house. Reverend Dr. Robert Ampiah-Kwofi. And the work that you have used him, his wife, these wonderful pastors, to do all over the years. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that as we move forward, Lord, we receive a new heart as members, as pastors, branch pastors, senior associates. A new heart, the heart of faithfulness, loyalty, to stand with him for this great work. Wherever we find ourselves, oh God, save us from the spirit of criticism and accusations and memory. Forgive us, many, oh God, that have, my God, been bedeviled with these saints. Forgive us and cleanse us. And give us great love for your servant and for this work. And bless it. Thank you that as we enter into 2016, your hand of mercy and grace will be upon this ministry. Thank you for fresh anointing, fresh energy, fresh zeal. Thank you for new frontiers, expansion. Thank you for the grace to take more territories. And our Lord, bless these wonderful pastors and these wonderful members, oh God. Lord, let 2016 be a wonderful year for them. A year that they will love you. A year that they will experience you in a special way. A year, oh God, that through the many will come into the kingdom. We love you and we bless you. And now, as every eye is closed, close your eyes. Put your hands down, please. Wherever you are standing, if you don't know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, I want you to know that you can be saved today. You can be saved today. Wherever you are standing, if you don't know the Lord, I want to pray for you before I sit down. Lift up only your right hand and I'll pray with you for you to receive Jesus Christ. You want to be a born-again Christian. You are living in your sins, but you want to become a born-again Christian. You want to receive the life of Jesus. Father, thank you for a blessing. We give you praise in the name of Jesus. I'd like to say a big thank you once again to Dr. Ampiah-Kwofi for the opportunity to minister. What a blessing. Let's welcome Pastor Brian. Jesus.
Father,